My name is Jonathan Nitzan. I'm a professor of political economy here at the Department of Political Science and in the graduate program in social and political thought. And this is the the third presentation in the speaker series on the capitalist mode of power. And the presenter today is James McMahon, who is a PhD student at the graduate program in social and political thought. And James will speak about Hollywood. James is going to defend his dissertation in a week time, we hope. And this talk, I think, is beyond his dissertation. It's material that grows out of his dissertation. And just a little bit of background, James's interests were in political philosophy and cultural studies. And he was particularly interested in the Frankfurt School and interested in the way that popular culture is modulated and transformed under capitalist conditions. And when we first met, when he took my course, he was interested in sort of complementing his analysis, cultural analysis, with something else. And what he did in his dissertation is to try to intersect it with the more deterministic aspects of business enterprise, and particularly with the attempts of business to reduce risk. So he generated a very interesting and, in my opinion, highly creative dissertation about risk reduction in Hollywood, in which he devised some quite ingenious indicators and ways of understanding the way that the destruction of culture, or at least the limitation of what Veblen calls the sabotage of culture, is being transformed into reduced risk and therefore increased capitalization for business enterprise. So this presentation is an expansion on this argument, and without further ado, I'll give the mic to James to begin his presentation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jonathan. So the first thing to, I double check, everyone has a chart book. Jonathan, could you actually pass the chart book? So this is actually something that will be, we'll go over through in sort of a later, later in the presentation, actually. So it's not instrumental to have right now. And actually, maybe I should mention right off the bat that this, I rehearsed this presentation and it will sort of go close to an hour. So I will, in fact, we'll take maybe a 10-minute break, maybe not exactly halfway through. Maybe when I sort of switch gears from a more sort of qualitative argument, and then in the second half when we start to look at some of the charts in more detail. So a break might be sort of useful that way. So today what I want to do is, as Jonathan was mentioning, my dissertation has primarily been focused on trying to study the political economy of Hollywood. And I guess the buzzword for my dissertation would be an analysis of risk. It's something that I've sort of fallen into in, through my empirical work, that I've sort of not really expecting to have an interest in it at first, but it's something that I started to feel would be central to my dissertation. So the purpose for the presentation today is actually to figure out how blockbuster cinema has been key to the contemporary Hollywood film business. Now, I should mention right off the bat that I'm not going to be looking at a particular blockbuster film, and I'm not really going to be looking at the ways blockbuster films are made exactly. I think what I can assume from the audience is that we all know what a blockbuster film is like. We've probably seen many of them, or they've been advertised to us. So if we all sort of collectively sort of know what a blockbuster film is usually like, today I can focus on some of the things and the strategies that surround blockbuster films, or this growing movement that many of you might have noticed, where Hollywood now seems to be even more obsessed with blockbusters than maybe it ever has been. So for example, there's now gonna be a new blockbuster wave essentially during Christmas time, which didn't exist 20 years ago. To give a visual representation of what I'm looking to do today, this is sort of what, this image I think has a sort of a very succinct sort of representation of how I sort of am interested in Hollywood cinema. Culture, cinema more generally, are very broad social relations. There's filmmakers, there's artists, there's consumers, there's writers, There's even meanings. So there's ways that we understand each other through language, but there's ways that we sort of understand and interpret films. So cinema is not really just about filmmakers, and it's not just about the DVDs that I own at home. It's about maybe something more broadly. Now, culture, I think many of us have, as we all have sort of experienced in many ways, can sometimes be an amorphous thing. It moves around, it sort of shifts. It has its own sort of movements depending on the ways that people actually interact with each other. From the perspective of capitalism, or more specifically from the perspective of capitalist investment, these sort of dynamic movements and shifts in society might not actually be something that they want. It might be something that they might feel is actually hindering their ability to invest and potentially profit from what they're looking at. So in this very simple representation, we have the social world of cinema put into a box. And by putting the social world of cinema into a box, and I'll sort of define and maybe give some examples of how you actually put it into a box, you make the social world of cinema orderly. You give it a defined trajectory. You find a way to say, okay, now that we sort of have sort of maybe cut across some of the edges, or as Jonathan has mentioned now in his introduction, if we look at the ways that power has an influence, you can take this social relationship and you can sort of constrain it in a way that it now actually has a defined movement. And that allows for predictability. So I mentioned earlier that we're going to be taking a break. So the presentation is going to be divided into four parts. We have part one, the limitation of social creativity. Part two, risk as a function of capitalist power. Part three, the effect of blockbusters on risk. And part four, the creation of order. Now, the reason that I structured my presentation this way is that there's some people in the room that are they're using the capitalist power framework for their own research. So they're already familiar. So some of the things that I'll be saying, they might either find repetitive or not exactly that helpful. But to make sure that everyone is sort of on the same page when we literally start to turn pages and look at this, I'm taking a bit of a longer road to some of the work that I'm currently working on to make sure that we can all sort of collectively look at this. And if you have any comments or criticisms, that I can receive them sort of in a good way. So let's start with part one, the limitation of social creativity. So there's many ways to study the relationship between politics and cinema. There's lots of courses, there's lots of books. If you're interested, there's many different approaches. And I think with this one, it's not necessarily a criticism of other approaches. Actually, this part is more my way to kind of say, this is how I am choosing to look at some of the power aspects of Hollywood cinema. So I think a good start is just to take one step forward and to say, okay, there's a political economy of culture. That's a good way in. So here we have a quotation from a well-known political economist of communication, Nicholas Garnham. And he argues that using political economy can actually be quite useful to understand how a delimited social group determines which meanings circulate and which do not, which stories are told and about what, which arguments are given prominence, and what cultural resources are made available and to whom. I find this definition useful for a number of reasons. One, it talks about the production of culture, but it talks about it in a bit of a looser meaning. It's about the production and distribution of meaning. And that, in relation to my interest in the social world of cinema, I think is a good way to wrestle with that problem that culture, yes, has a material aspect. So there's production costs and labor costs to the making of a film. You want to make comic books, you have to print that on ink and paper. But then there's the symbolic and then the images and the meaning. And these actually, in fact, have sometimes tremendous value. And we have to find a way to understand how culture can actually be commodified and given a price tag. The other reason that I like this definition is that it starts to introduce this idea that there's a class interest, there's an elite group, there's institutions. There are people that have a vested interest in sort of determining what stories get told and about what. So there's interest to actually control the production and distribution of meaning in some way. We haven't yet defined it, but there's this idea saying if I have a vested interest in something, I want to make sure that artists are either producing what I like or not producing what I don't like. So a way to sort of take this one step further and to sort of push this into my interest on risk, I do find Nicholas Garnham's definition very interesting, and I find many sort of general definitions of political economy of culture useful. But I think what always leaves me a bit wanting is that change in perspective. It's that change of perspective about maybe those in power or those that actually work in a film studio. So let's just assume that they do actually want to control meaning or that they want to modify or shape the way that meaning circulates in society. How do they do it? And what are the decisions that they actually have to make to be able to do that well? So I'll just give you one small example. So imagine you have a film project. You guys are all budding executives at a film studio, and someone walks into your office with a script and they say, this is the movie for you. This is the movie that you should make. This is the movie that the world wants to see. Already you have to start to make some decisions. So the decision that I have here is, it's a simple one, but it's actually a very important one. The number of opening theaters. So how many theaters should you open a film project in? One way to do it is to give it what is called a saturation release. Now, with a saturation release, the idea is that you release it wide. You release it all across Canada, you release it all across the United States on opening weekend. So this is something that we're actually very familiar with. I could just make an assumption and take a guess, but most of the movies that we actually see are movies that are released wide. So a big blockbuster or even a relatively big movie is released in many theaters on opening weekend. So that decision alone has its own sort of consequences. So you say, okay, if I'm going to take your film project and put it into a saturation release, it's going to have probably have a few stars in it, and we're going to have to advertise the hell out of this thing. So the actors are going to have to go on Conan O'Brien and The Tonight Show. And we're going to have to make sure that this movie is sort of living up to the costs that we are going to dump into it. Another way to release a movie is to give it a limited release. So you are still that executive and someone comes in with a script and they say, this is the movie you should make. And you look at it and you say, you know, it's a bit too artsy or it's got an independent feel. I'm not sure if everyone's going to be liking this movie. Maybe it'll be popular in New York or Chicago or Toronto. But is this something that's really going to blow up the same way that Avengers or Star Wars blows up? So what you do is you give it a limited release. You open it in a few theaters, and then you wait for this. You just wait to see if there's any word of mouth, if there's any buzz, if there's any way for the movie to actually generate a bit of its own heat. And if it does, great. But if it doesn't, well, then it can sort of go away. So even in that hypothetical example, you can start to see that from the perspective of the studios, they might start to look at creativity a bit differently than the way that we value creativity. So I've been working on the political economy of film for many years now, and I love cinema, and I don't value the movies that I watch in any way the way that I actually do my research on cinema. So when I watch a movie, I'm not really assessing it for its risk, or I'm not trying to put a dollar amount on it. But if you work in a studio, you need to start to adopt some of these strategies. So if you're in the studio, you're looking out into this world of creativity, this world of people that want to create movies or people that want to get into the film industry. And I just put it in a very simple, abstract way. You have a set of inputs. Now, in this case, I just have this sort of a list of variables that would go on and on. But this is just the idea that there's all of these inputs. People are approaching you. They're telling you to make these movies, or they're telling you to produce this, or they're telling you to work on this. And you need to start to make some decisions. So the first decision you can make is whether you actually reject something right off the bat. So someone tells you an idea and you say, no way, that movie is not going to get made here. In fact, that movie is either too controversial or too political, or it's just not what we're looking for. So you have some ideas that you just throw off the table immediately. The next one is you have film projects to develop. So this would be a tentative thumbs up. It's this idea that you've said, we're interested. We might buy the rights to produce the film, but that doesn't mean that we're going to produce it. So if you wrote a very interesting novella, a studio might say, we'll buy the rights to make this movie, but it doesn't mean that we'll actually make it. But we are the ones that have that interest in making it, should we ever do it. So from there, you have another yes or no decision. You then have to decide, of all the properties you own or all the properties that you're working on, which ones are you actually going to green light? Which ones are you actually going to say, these are the movies that I'm going to produce, and these are the ones that we're going to distribute. And in relation to my other slide, you then have to make a decision. Are you going to release it wide? Are you going to release it small? What are you going to do? So I think it's just a good way to sort of give a bit more of a context about exactly how this might actually relate to examples of control. I'll just give the remainder of this part's the presentation on this part with just a few more examples. So one of them that you might have heard of are pitch meetings. So with pitch meetings, it's a bit like a job interview, but in this case, you have someone getting a chance to essentially pitch their idea. Now, much like George Costanza here trying to sell Seinfeld on the idea that it's a show about nothing, usually in a pitch meeting, it's a very short meeting. It's 20 to 30 minutes most. So what you usually do in a pitch meeting is you sell your idea as succinctly and as clearly as possible. So you say, my movie is about this, and you leave it with only a few words or a few sentences. You don't have a chance to do a long presentation. In fact, you don't even get a chance to do a presentation that I'm doing today, which I'm getting the opportunity to talk longer than 20 minutes at usual academic conferences. So you have to really get to the point. Steven Spielberg, for example, has a quotation of how he, as an executive producer, assesses the quality of a pitch. He says, if a person can tell me the idea in 25 words or less, it's going to make a pretty good movie. I like ideas, especially movie ideas that you can hold in your hand. Now, I'm not going to be talking too much about it. I'm not going to be talking about it today, but in previous presentations, I've looked at high concept cinema. The problem with this is that it actually creates a feedback loop. Because if this is the style of pitch meetings, this is almost the standard that actually gets movies to go through. So what ends up happening is people start having to push to actually design movies to be as simple and as straightforward as possible. So if your movie is a bit too political or a bit too philosophically complex, and it's really difficult, sometimes when we try to describe our own research, to describe it in one sentence, then you sort of get this idea in your head that you have to take what you have and simplify it, sometimes potentially to the destruction of ambiguity or complexity, or even maybe something that is a bit interesting but not exactly relevant. So the other one is what is sort of casually described as development hell. So with that yellow box on that sort of slide with all the inputs, the development process is referred to development hell because usually about only one in 50 movies actually get produced. So what you actually have is you have this big limbo stage in Hollywood where Hollywood says yes to your movie, yes to your idea, and then it just sort of sits around, and then sometimes through some administrative changes, the boss that actually approved your script gets fired or moves somewhere else. So the very idea that you thought would actually make it to the screens is going to sit on a shelf somewhere. Now, the screenwriter, playwright, and director David Mamet, with his experiences in Hollywood, he says one of the key problems with film development is that executives don't read scripts. So he's gone into meetings where the higher-ups, even when they produce and distribute a movie, have admitted that they actually don't read anything. So there's jobs of the script reader. So the script readers sometimes have that task of going into the development section and picking movies out of development to saying, hey, maybe there's something here that we should produce. But according to David Mamet, it doesn't exactly solve the problem because this is what they do. The job of the script reader involves figuring out what the studios might like, brackets money, and giving them the illusion that the dedicated employee, through strict adherence to the mechanical weeding process, can provide it. So with one more example, I've already been kind of talking for a while, so I'm going to take a few more sips of water. So I think that it would be good to maybe just change the tone a bit and have a bit of an audio play. So this is from the public radio show This American Life. So this is just an example that I found. I don't really need to give too much of an introduction to it. I think hopefully I can turn the speaker up loud enough that the audio file will be self-explanatory. But I guess just the small background is that he's interviewing someone who's talking about their experience in trying to develop a movie in Hollywood.
Act three, wait, don't film me. Now, this origin story, Our colleague at WBEZ and the host of the public radio show Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me, Mr. Peter Sagal, used to be a playwright. And to give you a sense of the kind of work that he did as a playwright, his most successful play, he says, was about a Holocaust denier and the Jewish attorney who represented that Holocaust denier in court.
And so it was all, you know, intellectual arguments and drama and involved the Holocaust and questions of the First Amendment law. And it came to the attention of this producer, Lawrence Bender, who is most well known for being Quentin Tarantino's producer. So he produced, among many other movies, Reservoir Dogs and Pulp Fiction and so on and so forth.
Back in the 90s when all this happened, Bender read Peter's play and liked it and called him up and asked Peter if he wanted to write a movie. And Peter basically had been waiting for this phone call from Hollywood forever.
I mean, there was, I think the year of 1992, my annual income was $10,000. This was the phone call that you wait for.
So after tossing around some different ideas for this film, Lawrence Bender introduces Peter to this woman who he works with, who at 15 had been an American in Cuba when the Cuban Revolution happened. Maybe there's a film in that. So Peter starts writing this film that's half romance, growing up film, half politics, about an American teenage girl in Cuba in the 50s.
And I didn't know anything about the Cuban Revolution, but one of the things I found out was that everybody involved with it was incredibly young. Castro himself was only 29. They were all 17, 18, 19, 20 years old, these guys up in the mountains with him. And one of the things that actually happened was almost as soon as they took over, the Cuban Revolution, these wonderful young Democrats, you know, freedom-loving rebels from the mountains, started executing people on television. And in my original conception, there were two parallel stories. There was Maria, who I called the central character, who had a rebellious, more typically adolescent rebellion going against her own parents. Mm-hmm. And then there was her romantic interest, a character named Josefo, who was a Cuban and was a sort of a third column rebel underground guy living and working in Havana to undermine the regime, sometimes through violence.
And eventually this film did get made.
It did.
It finally got made a bit later, and I'm just going to play a clip here from it.
Oh, God, I love dancing with him.
Did it ever occur to you that that boy might be using you? Nice American girl
no,
who can be his
please,
ticket out
no,
of
that's
you
not
may
true.
Love dancing with that boy, but there are more important factors here, like your family and your future.
Why does it have to be either or? Just because you gave up your passion, why should I?
So that's a clip from the film. You want to just let people know the title of the film?
The title of the film is Dirty Dancing 2, : Havana Nights.
I have to say, I watched the movie last night. I watched Dirty Dancing 2.
The whole thing?
Yeah.
There is not a single line of dialogue in that movie that I wrote.
So how does the film go from political coming-of-age drama to Dirty Dancing 2, Havana Nights? Well, of course, it's an old Hollywood story. Peter writes his film. He turns it in. They ask him to make it more like, could it be more like Dirty Dancing, Innocent Girl with a Semi-Dangerous Guy.
And sometimes I think back on the experience and I say, you know, I should have said to them, hey, if that's what you want, I'm really not the guy for it.
He says each draft got worse and worse. Even he didn't like it. Finally, it was shelved. Years later, the producer who actually owned the rights to the film Dirty Dancing teamed up with Lawrence Bender to make a sequel, and somebody thought of Peter's old script. All the politics of the film got reduced to this one moment where, really unconnected to anything else in the film, somebody attempts to shoot some unidentified political figure at the climax of the dance contest. And then later, in a moment of obligatory foreshadowing, our couple talks about whether Castro would ever kick out Americans from Cuba.
I'm just saying that.
What, that I might have to leave?
Could happen.
But they wouldn't do that. Not if the whole idea is to give people their freedom.
So, on to part two. Risk as a function of capitalist power. It might be a bit difficult to see from here, but this is a picture that I found only a few days ago, and I thought it'd be very appropriate for this section with sort of this capitalist interest in risk. So this is a CBS memo that was going around in 1969 about Miles Davis. So right now, this is just Project 03802. And the memo just says, Miles just called and said he wants his album to be titled Bitches Brew. Please advise. So with the influx and the input of creativity, then comes this question of my interest in the ways that risk becomes a factor in understanding how, like that example that we heard with the scriptwriter taking a political movie and turning it into eventually it becoming something like Dirty Dancing 2. How does that happen? Why does that happen? And how does that maybe relate to risk? So for those that are already familiar with this, my apologies if it's repetitive, but I hope it's still hopefully a way to sort of, make sure that we're all sort of clear about this. So Jonathan, in his presentation 2 weeks ago, I think just gave a very succinct definition of capitalization. And it's a way that you can just understand its two basic elements as a way to say this is a bridge that we can use for further study. So it's future expected earnings discounted to present prices and adjusted for risk. So my main interest, not really through my own theoretical leanings, but it's just where this is some of the empirical research has taken me, is that Hollywood's adjustment for risk has been something that has been very instrumental to it in the past 30 years. So in a more theoretical way, Jonathan and Shimshon write in their book that risk is the expression of the degree of confidence capitalists have in their own predictions. So it's making a prediction, but then it's trying to assess how confident you are in that prediction. So right below with the K with EE over the lowercase Greek delta, the idea of that is to sort of say that you have this idea of expected earnings. You have an expectation for future earnings, and you can put a value in there, and this is happening all the time. But then it's trying to understand, well, how confident are you in that return? Because you're trying to discount these future expected earnings to present prices. So just as a very small example, when confidence goes down and risk increases, the same expected earnings are discounted to lower present prices. So as risk increases, that expectation of 200 million expected is discounted to 117 million when risk has increased relative to just that very simple example where risk equals one. So to give just a bit more of a way to sort of a bit of an example to sort of take that risk, my interest in risk a bit further, I think what I've mostly been interested in is this understanding of how this interest in the reduction of risk starts to sort of shape the way that you're interested in the future of cinema. So you start to have expectations about the future of cinema because you're asking yourselves, well, how are future income eventually going to turn into real streams of earnings? So if you are trying to think, I need to make a movie in 3 years, you're also trying to think, what will cinema be like in 3 years? And will that movie that I say will do well, will it do well or will it not? So to just have another sort of fun hypothetical example, you can have an ambitious screenwriter that could, for example, say, I want to do a remake of Douglas Sirk's 1940 film, All That Heaven Allows. And you can say, great, it's an excellent movie. There's some potential here. So as someone who maybe knows about film or as maybe as someone, a lover of art, you might say, well, there's some meat to this project because, well, in the 70s, Rainer Werner Fassbinder made an explicit remake of it called Ali, Fear Eats the Soul. And then you can say, well, Wong Kar-wai's In the Mood for Love was also a sort of a loose adaptation of that. And that actually did quite well. So artistically, this might be a really good avenue to go down. But then the question is, how would this be translated into expected earnings? So just as a small example, someone says, it doesn't matter, it could be the screenwriter, it could be someone working in accounting, or it could be even your own sort of intuition. You say, you know what, this actually has the potential to make 100 million in US theatrical revenues. So just as a way to get a sense of whether that is actually feasible, you need to start to do that translation of the expectations about the future of cinema and translate that into your expectations about income. So if just hypothetically the average ticket price was $5, that means 20 million people have to see this film, assuming that it's one viewing per person. So already you're starting to do a translation in your head of trying to figure out, will this project be able to actually achieve what you might think or what might be sort of told about you from the creative side. So I think it might be good to just take a small quick break because from there I'll be sort of moving through some of the charts. So I guess we could take a 10-minute break and kind of come back. Welcome back. For those that went outside and realized that the hallway is 10 degrees colder than in here, Hopefully I'll make this as painless as possible. So for the next two parts, we're going to start to go through some of the charts in the chart book. And for a few parts, I feel that if you'll indulge me, I will sort of read from a paper that I'm working on just to make sure that I'm sort of articulating and speaking on certain points just as clearly as possible, so that if we're looking at a specific part of the chart and I'm actually using an actual number or something a bit more technical, that I'm speaking about it rather than kind of a bit more sort of casually. So now that I sort of established my interest in risk, and in this case represented from the lowercase delta, when you get interested in something like this, there obviously isn't just one sort of easy thing to look at and you can say, aha, there you go, risk is found, and we can sort of analyze it and determine it exactly. In fact, most of my struggle from my dissertation was actually even trying to find relevant data or even trying to find a way to talk about this lowercase delta, sometimes through proxies or indirect means, because as you'll probably see in some of the things that I'm going to show you in my charts, some of it is, it's obviously based off of financial data, but it's not presented in the way that I in fact do it, that there's annual reports don't look at risk in the same way that I look at it. So it's not like there's a table in an annual report of Disney that would sort of tell me exactly what I need to know. In fact, you have to do a lot of work to see if you can try to come up with a way of getting an understanding of what this means. So these are just some of the ways, I guess, in my dissertation that I look at risk. So there's all sorts of terms on there. There's discipline of creative labor, consumer habits. I was talking about high concept filmmaking. There's a broad, I have a sort of a broad definition of ideology. So, and even there's a few points that are not even sort of covered with a name. So if anyone has any sort of suggestions or criticisms, there's many ways to sort of try to get a better understanding of this. But the way that I've sort of looked at it and the way that I sort of felt that has sort of helped me really get my feet sort of on the ground is to look at saturation booking. So yes, Blockbusters is in the title of this presentation, but I think this is that aspect of the strategy that I'm going to be talking about. So relative, when I said at the beginning that we all sort of have an assumption of what a blockbuster film is, we can still hold to that and we can sort of say, okay, how are they making decisions relative to this idea of we need blockbusters to be doing very, very well? And saturation booking is a way for me to get a sense of how well they're actually doing it. So this is a figure that I've done some presenting on before. I'm not going to go over it in too much detail today, because some of the work that I'm doing today is actually a sort of a step forward in that work. But this, I think, was essentially one of the keystones to all of my research. It was essentially the figure that told me that I should actually be looking at risk in Hollywood cinema. So I didn't go into this project with a theoretical sort of frame, and I didn't write my proposal exactly with this mind saying, I'm going to look at risk, and that's going to be it, and that's going to be the story that I'm going to tell. In fact, it was this figure that kind of turned me on my head rather than the other way around. So what this shows, or I guess maybe rather than first shows, I can just explain of what I was trying to do with this. So the reason that opening theater data I found to be a very useful proxy for risk is because decisions about opening theaters are made before any revenue starts to flow. So yes, you find data on movies that were in fact released, but if you go on a database that says this movie was opened in 3,000 theaters, that decision about that opening was made before any dollar was even associated with the revenues of that film. So when you start to rank and organize the world of cinema according to opening theaters, you get a proxy of how sort of the expectations might in fact go. So to test this hypothesis, I did two things. I sorted all of the sort of revenues of the top 10% of films for each year, and I sorted them by opening theaters. I also did what is commonly done if you go to a site like Box Office Mojo, and I took the the top 10% of films, and I sorted them by revenues. So in this series, these are the films that were released in the top 10% most theaters in the United States, and this series is the most the top 10% films by their gross revenues. The bottom series is a ratio of the two. And what that ratio tells us is, in fact, that as time goes on, those two series are including more and more of the same films. So this is a ratio that is going down. So it's the ratio of revenues to theaters. So not only is it relatively high, but it fluctuates and starts to taper off close to one. So when you move into the 2000s, you get, when I was talking to Blair outside, you get essentially a form of a power distribution. The widest opening films are also the ones, surprise, surprise, that also get the most revenues. But the reason that I found this interesting was that there's actually a bit of a historical transformation here. We might say that makes sense. If you release a movie wide, it should get the most revenues. But even this historical trend tells us that this was actually a development. This was a push by Hollywood to make sure that that actually happened. So I did a presentation on this 2 years ago. This was in the speaker series, the first speaker series on capitalist power. And I was speaking with a colleague of mine who's actually presenting not next week, because that's actually canceled, Sandy. But I was speaking with Troy, so he'll be presenting in 2 weeks. And I was speaking to Troy about this figure. And some of his suggestions, and I was telling him that I was thinking about it as well, was, if that's actually true about the top 10%, what's happening to the rest of the cinematic universe? So while this is sort of becoming more and more sort of orderly, is the cinematic universe below it still this chaotic mess of performance? Or is this push actually changing the way that other movies actually relate? So that was 2 years ago. It was a good conversation. It sort of helped me get some ideas in my head. And then last year I watched a film called The Magnificent Ambersons by Orson Welles. For those that haven't seen it, it's a movie about the decline of the wealthy aristocratic Amberson family at the start of the 20th century in the United States. Here's a famous shot of Major Ambison sort of staring off at the end of the film as his family has just completely fallen into decline. The reason that this movie had actually a very strong impact on my thinking about how to pursue with this sort of work was because in this movie they have a friend called Eugene Morgan, and he's an upstart entrepreneur, and he's in the brand new auto business. And so this is in the 1910s, and they have all these dinner parties, and they talk to Eugene Morgan about the growth of automobiles. And this family, they're very skeptical. They mock him. They sort of say, really, are automobiles going to take off? People are really going to replace a horse and carriage? How uncivilized, blah, blah, blah. It's this old aristocratic family that can't actually see the change in front of them. So, but I don't need to tell you, obviously, Eugene Morgan as an upstart auto entrepreneur in the 20s goes to great wealth, and this blindsides this family. They didn't even see it coming. So the reason that this is very influential on me was because I thought, okay, so if you have this top band, defining predictability relative to success, you can also define it relative to failure. So you can say, I'm confident that my movie will succeed, but you also can say, I'm confident that my movie will succeed and others won't succeed. So once you know that other element about other films not being able to sort of challenge you, you then actually get an increased confidence, because not only do you know that blockbusters will do well, but you also know that small independent films really won't challenge you for revenues. They'll get a bit of buzz and they'll win a few awards, but will they become so big? So if you'll indulge me, we can sort of start to go through some of the chart book. So some of the questions then, if I could articulate them a bit more specifically, is, does Hollywood need to worry about quote unquote surprises? i.e. smaller releases that end up outperforming films that were expected to be top performers. How far and how often does the average wide release strategy fall below capitalist expectations? What proportion of films with small releases outperform those with wider releases? And is this proportion fixed or changing? So those are some of the questions that I'm really trying now to work on and try to understand. So figure one presents the relationship between opening theaters and yearly revenue shares of films released from 1984 to 2013 in the United States. The chart contains individual observations of 10,922 films, all of which were released theatrically in the United States from 1984 to 2013. Each observation shows the number of theaters a particular film opened, so that's on the x-axis, and the total revenue of that film as a percent of its respective year's total US gross box office revenues. So to quickly clarify that point, I was getting what is often called just the nominal data of revenue just in prices, and often there's ways of decisions of how you're actually going to sort of all bring that down to the same playing field so you can compare prices in 1984 to those prices in 2013 or wherever, or whenever. So what I did was, for each year, I put everything into a percent share of its yearly revenues. So obviously this isn't looking at date, but if there's a dot that's up close to that 10, that means that observation in its own year got 10% of that year's revenues. So there's actually it's a positive but a moderate correlation between opening theaters and yearly revenue share. So it's a Pearson correlation of 0.58. But it is significant enough to challenge the common assumption that risk in the Hollywood film business is extremely high. More specifically, figure one shows us that there are in fact two types of openings. One, those that are small in opening theater size and whose upper and lower bounds for yearly film revenue share are separated by several orders of magnitude. So this is actually a logarithmic scale. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So that's 9 orders of magnitude. So the difference between the top and the bottom is actually enormous. So some are making 10%, but if you can see some close to the very bottom, they made 0.00001% of all revenue in their year. And two, there are those that are widely released and whose film revenues are positively correlated to the number of theaters they open at. Moreover, for the second group, predictability seems to increase with the number of opening theaters. So take as an illustration all the films that were opened in less than 1,500 theaters. So this is that band right here. Only 104 were able to reach 1% in yearly revenue share. On the other hand, if you look at films with more than 1,500 theaters, 712 of 3,318 films were able to gain more than 1%. So there's still a few that will drop below 1%, but if you can start to see closer to that edge, that chance of sort of dipping down is not there. So this bounded degree of risk actually becomes clearer if we start grouping our observations. And the reason that I'm grouping the observations is that for that top right quadrant, which is up there in the top right over there, this is essentially the nearly exclusive domain of the Hollywood major firms, which are Columbia, Disney, Paramount, 20th Century Fox, Universal, and Warner Brothers. So in 2013, for instance, these six collectively distributed or had a hand in distributing 90% of all films that opened in 3,000 or more theaters. So to better visualize the extent of this concentration, I rank the films in each year from 1984 to 2013 according to the number of theaters they were opened at from highest to lowest. And then what I do is that I take those and then I put them into 10 equally sized bins, or sometimes the verb is binning your data. So in this case, we have 10 bins of data ranked by opening theaters per film. So this is on table one on the sheet. So you can see that in each bin, the annual average number of films is 37. And then the annual average opening theaters per film is different because in fact, this is how I ranked the data. I sorted the data first. So just as a small example, if you have a film that opened in bin two, the average bin two film would open in 2,254 films. The average bin nine film would open in 4 films. Cinema. Oh, sorry. Number of theaters. Yes. Thank you for that, Cliff.
So it's like deciles, really.
Yeah. Deciles. Yeah. So figure two presents the results of this data organization. So each bin has 30 observations, one for the average share for each year from 1984 to 2013. And the gray lines indicate the overall average revenue share of that bin. So at first glance, the curve in figure two, for those familiar with the idea of distributions, this long tail of revenue distribution, this idea that there's a minority of films that collect the majority of revenues, and then the rest are sort of left in this long tail of revenue share. So that is true, but what is important is that I've already sorted the data according to revenue size, theater size. So it actually visualizes the relationship between bin rank and each bin's share of US gross revenues. And from there we can see that films with the largest opening theaters will, as a group, receive a share of revenues that is bigger than any other quote-unquote group of films. Also, for all the years from 1984 to 2013, the lowest share of bin one, so that dot down at the bottom over there, is 19.7%. And this is larger than that of every single year for bins 4 through 10. So if you're released, if we go back to table one, essentially if you're released in less than 500 theaters, you don't have a chance of actually beating any film in bin one. Sorry, I just need to organize myself here. Sorry about that, I'm just gonna do this. So looking at the yearly performance of films ranked by their opening theaters, we can assess the relation between Hollywood's degree of confidence in its widest releases on the one hand, and this risk of smaller releases reaching unexpectedly high shares of revenue on the other. So to be confident about a distribution strategy is to have a pretty clear idea of how a film will rank relative to its cohorts. So like I said earlier, I have this idea that my film will do well, but then relative to my cohorts, I have a stronger indication that others won't do so well. So according to figures one and two, over the past 30 years, both of these requirements have been systematically fulfilled. What we have here in figure three, I'm presenting the historical performance of our 10 bins, which are still ranked by opening theaters. So each series shows a distributive share of a bin's revenue over time, and it is smoothed as a 3-year trailing average. So this figure demonstrates how the top 10% of films ranked by opening theaters has increased its share of all US box office gross revenues over a 30-year period. So for example, if you look at bin one, and yes, it's a 3-year trailing average, but if you look at 1986, that's at 22%, and by 2013, that's 67%. But I think figure three is also interesting for another reason, a few reasons, and this is where I will then kind of continue on with some of my figures. What I find also interesting about this is that you can see a few other things. So one of them that you can see is bin two. So bin two sort of actually makes it out of this entanglement with other series, and over time it becomes its own sort of series that is separated from others. So it's clearly not doing as well as bin one, but all of the sort of series below it are now no longer in competition with bin two. The other thing that I find really interesting is that you have annual growth rates. So bin one and two are the only one with a positive annual growth rate during this time. Every other bin shrank in revenue share from the 80s all the way to the 2000s. So what you can also see, and it's somewhat purposeful because I break this down in more detail, is that there's a bit of an entanglement at the bottom. You have series that are sort of outperforming one another, one sort of increasing over. So this, for example, I think is number bin four, that's bin three. So bin four has a few jumps where it actually makes a few leaps higher than other bins. So it's able to actually, in this case, potentially surprise someone because it's able to sort of go beyond its expectations. But that entanglement seems to really exist at the bottom, where you have all this sort of seemingly crisscrossing of performance. You're doing well one week, and then your friend's doing really well the next, but then you're back to doing well the next week, and it's this up and down sort of game. So to explain the way that I'm actually going to work through this, so this is back to figure two. You don't necessarily need to look at it because I can sort of visualize it up here, is that what we need to start to get is a sense of this entanglement of the bins. So the correlation between opening theaters and revenue size, although only moderate, enables Hollywood to assess whether the overall composition of the world of cinema is worrisome financially. So in a given period, some revenues will exceed expectations while other streams will underwhelm investors. So we can assume, relative to the sort of the idea that we've already established, that there's a positive correlation between theater performance and opening theater size, that there's a benchmark order for theatrical performance to which actual rankings can be compared. So the overall averages of figure one, these gray lines, provide us with a good starting point of what I mean by that. So it's a way to understand how performance rank, this rank, like I'm in first place or you're in second place or someone's in third place, is meaningful to risk perceptions. So if we just look at the gray lines, except for bins 7, 8, and 9, the gray lines constitute a ranked list where bin 1 has a larger share than bin 2, bin 2 has a larger share than bin 3, and so on. So this 1 is better than 2, and 2 is better than 3, and 3 is better than 4. This list can be presented as a sequence where the bins are ordered from highest to lowest according to their shares of box office revenues. So we can present it as a sequence. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then 8, 9, 7, 10. So the red numbers are actually deviating from what we assume to be this ideal organization, where 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 is that ideal sequence. The reason that that is the ideal sequence is because that's where you have a positive correlation between opening theater rank and yearly revenue share. So this is where I get into two concepts of deviation. So this idea that you have a benchmark and you have historical data, you can then assess your historical data relative to that benchmark and say to yourself, are we in fact meeting it, or are we sort of deviating from it wildly? So here we have that ideal, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And the first deviation is a deviation of movement. So for example, in the sequence 1, 2, 4, 3, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, there's two deviations of movement. 4 switched with 3, and 3 switched with 4. So what we mean in that case is that bin 4 outperformed 3, and bin 3 underperformed 4. So if we go back to that sequence in figure 2, which I just said, we actually have three deviations of movement. So when I read out that sequence and then we got to 8, 9, 7, once again, you have three bins that are actually changing their places. The next one is a deviation of degree. So this measures how far each bin is out of place. So if we go back to just a very simple example, the deviation of movement is 2, and the deviation of degree is 2, because bin 4 is in third place, and bin 3 is in fourth place. So that movement and degree are actually the same. But then if you separate, the movement of the two is actually further away, you actually get a larger deviation of degree, where bin 9 and bin 4 are actually much further away from where they ideally should be. So for example, this might actually indicate an instance of very high uncertainty, because as we established, bin 9 is a movie that only opens in 4 theaters. So if that can jump all the way to fourth place, and your bin four that is being released in many, many, many more theaters is actually falling well below in ranking, this is a situation where that even that simple substitution of two bin performances could actually be much more severe. So when I was working on this paper, I sort of felt that there's, even for my own edification, there's always a way that we can try to find a way to make even just an example to make this a bit clearer, just so I don't feel like I'm just getting lost in my own concepts. So in this case, what we have in this figure is just two examples. We have 1994 and we have 2012. So that thick gray bar in the chart is rank and revenue, rank and box office revenues, and that is just bins, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So you actually have it just in its ideal sequence. So if one is in first place, and then second is in second place, and third is in third place, that's what you get. You just get a straight line in the chart. From there, I then just plotted 1994 and 2012 just to get an indication of what visually what would this look like. So in 1994, you have a deviation of movement of 7 and of degree of 12. Of 2012, already maybe a hint that I'm sort of moving somewhere with this, is that you have a deviation of movement of 4 and a deviation of degree of 6. So that 2012 series, although it's not perfect, is closer and sort of more tightly sort of correlated to that ideal than 1994. So what I did there then is I just then plotted every single year that I had for this these two series. So in my opinion, this figure actually demonstrates how films are sort of gradually falling into their quote-unquote right places, which in turn means that the wide release strategy has become increasingly successful. So from 1984 to 1998, you actually have a higher, more bins are relatively out of place. So the average deviation of degree was 10. In the next 15 years, you can actually see that there's a drop in both the degree and movement, and that actually still includes 2013. That's something that I don't actually yet have an answer to of why 2013 is just, it's sort of shot. I have the numbers to explain which bins made that, and it was a movement between 8 and 3, but out of there, it was just once again a significant jump that I would have to sort of investigate further. So far I've been sort of researching the effect of the saturation booking strategy. But I think the way that it needs to be strongly connected is back to my sort of conception or my interest in this idea of power. So when I started this presentation talking about all the examples of control and all the ways that Hollywood might actually have a hand in shaping shaping the effect that this data is representing. So Hollywood might actually be sort of driving the car, so to speak, with respect to its performance, I need to have a bit of a stronger conception of this creation of order. So this is just a bit of a background. This is a figure that's in my dissertation. And this was a figure that I think genuinely made me curious. Because as I think Jonathan even mentioned it in his presentation, here you have the differential operating income. So you have the profits of Hollywood benchmarked against the largest US firms. In this case, what I'm calling the dominant capital 500. More specifically, for those that are interested, I got that off of CompuStat. If you're interested, you can talk to me. So that's a measure of its differential profits. Then we have a measure of its differential capital, its capitalization benchmarked against the performance of the largest US firms, again, using dominant capital 500 and again, going through CompuStat. But the reason that I think that this sort of leaves a question mark and why I'm studying the things that I'm studying is there's this very noticeable divergence. So as Jonathan mentioned in his presentation, the profits, the level of profits of Hollywood are not anything to write home about. So if you just look at its profits going sideways, just from that alone, you might just conclude, well, Hollywood's not doing so well. But then once you compare it to its capitalization, you have a question on your hands and you say, what could this be and how could it be done? And what I'm arguing is that this reduction of risk is systematic, that it's not something that is accidental. It's something that they are doing purposefully as a way to, in fact, do what you actually see here, which is increase their differential capitalization even when their profits are going sideways. So this goes back to what I was saying at the start of the presentation, where I'm interested in this ways that capitalist power could have sort of an effect on the social relations of cinema. So when I started this presentation, I talked about the world of culture could maybe be this chaotic mess that moves it around in unpredictable ways. But with respect to risk assessment, that's not what you want. You, in fact, might want something like this, where you can say, I actually have a way to determine that my ideas about what movies to distribute are useful. So this goes to the average US theatrical release window for the major studios. So this, to me, was a clue that there's actually a way to shape the order of cinema. So here what we have, I got this from the National Association of Theater Owners. They use the acronym NATO, but I don't think they know that there's actually another NATO out there. So when you Google NATO, you have to just Google the National Association of Theater Owners. But from here, you have two things. You have video release and video announcement. So just to make sure that I'm not confusing the two. Yes. Okay. So video announcement is the average number of days between opening day in theaters and the day when video release plans are announced by the company. Now, this is a signal that a theatrical release is closing or already closed. So it's not an exact on this day, it's no longer in theaters, but usually the way that the distribution system works, when you're gearing up to video release, even today, this means that movies are, it might be a slow decline in theaters. The other one is a bit more helpful in the sense that it's actually that difference between opening day and the day when a movie is actually released on video, and now it would be Blu-ray and DVD and all other sorts of media. So I think one of the sort of reasons that this is happening is because of piracy and bootlegging. We sort of seen this strategy with various businesses that are interested in culture. How are we going to sort of beat this wave of piracy? In some ways, to actually try to beat them to the punch. So rather than you downloading an illegal copy of a movie, some companies actually say, we'll just release the movie digitally sooner than later so you can just buy a legit copy. It doesn't always work, but that's one of the strategies. But the other thing that I find really interesting about this is that this is actually shortening the window that movies are actually, the amount of time that movies are actually in theaters. And the reason that this is interesting is how movies actually make money. So when we went back to that decision, when I was talking about that decision tree you had in part one, that should I release a movie big or should I release it small? The thing about this is that this actually is redistributing risk downwards. So what I mean by that is you have some films where this shortened window, and I'll show with an example, doesn't really matter. They're already getting the bulk of the revenues before that window, that average window even closes. But for artistic, independent films that have those small releases, they need what is generally called word of mouth. It does need a bit of buzz. So you need to tell your friends, or you need, if it opens in Toronto and New York, people need to then start to say, hey, when this movie gets to your city, maybe in a week or 2 weeks, you should really see this when this gets a slightly larger release. So to just give one example, this is 2001. So the average of the video release, I'm just going to double check that it's not video release or video announcement. I think it's, oh no, it's video announcement. So the interval between opening day and video announcement is 101 days. So that's that, again, that indication that this theatrical window is closing up. So here we have two movies in 2001 that were released in 2001. The Mummy Returns, the sequel to the Mummy, and the Coen brothers' Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? So for the Mummy to make 90% of its revenues, theatrical revenues, it only needed 35 days. For Oh Brother, Where Art Thou, it needed 112 days to make 90% of its revenues, which were, I think, 5 or 6 times smaller, maybe even smaller than the Mummy. Now, the reason that this is actually even potentially more worrisome is that Oh Brother, Where Art Thou was actually a successful small release. So this movie had enough staying power to actually stay in theaters for 112 days. There's many small independent films that are sort of not so lucky, so they don't get a chance to actually get close to that line. The other sort of figure that has sort of gained a sense that there's a sort of a systematic push here is that this figure looks at the opening theater size of each series is the annual number of opening theaters per film in two adjacent bins. So just for the sake of presentation, I took two bins, so 1 and 2, 3 and 4, 5 and 6, and so on. And like that table, I just did what are its average number of theaters per film in that bin. So what is interesting about this is that in the 80s, many movies, even movies that got quote-unquote smaller releases, were relatively close to the larger release films. So yes, there were some blockbusters in the 80s, but movies that were released in lower tiers were still getting a decent fair share of theaters. Not the exact same as bin one, but they were getting something significant. Then, as you can see, over time, what actually in fact starts happening is that each one starts to make its, and again, this is a logarithmic scale, each series starts to make its significant declines getting closer and closer to one. So bin 9 and 10, so these would be the smallest releases in the 80s, would still get about 45 theaters. Now it's been flatlining at one since the 2000s. I think even more troubling is that bins 5 and 6, this was sort of hovering around 1,000 theaters, and now it's down to 5. So that idea of a medium release movie or a medium weight movie is really starting to disappear. And in fact, if your movie is not in the top tier and you say, well, hopefully I can release it and get it in another tier and people will see it, it's in fact sort of staying now in much lesser theaters. So to conclude, thank you for sort of putting up with all of this. To conclude, this has been my interest for quite a while and I've been very focused on it. But I think what a way for me to sort of step forward in my research is to sort of take a bit of a wider lens and to start to see how I can get a better sense of this lowercase delta. So, congratulate myself for looking at saturation booking, but then trying to then say, okay, there might be some other things that I need to bring into this, because for those that are have been engaging in empirical research or those that are starting to, some of the challenges is just even trying to find the data that is relevant to even tell the story that you're trying to tell. So I welcome any questions and comments. Thank you.
Stimulating and impressive presentation. So we'll start taking questions. I just want those who ask questions to take the time to take the mic and speak to the mic. You might not feel any difference, but this is how the voice will get to the video. So please go ahead.
Hi, James. How do you think this your presentation and this kind of change in Hollywood's ability to shape blockbuster films is related to the actual change in the physical infrastructure of cinemas and the rise of cineplexes with, 20, 20 films playing at once and the collapse of smaller theaters.
Okay, yeah, so I think I'll take one question at a time. So I think that is something that is, in fact, very relevant. Maybe for those that are not familiar, that it used to be in the 20s and 30s and even in the 40s, some of the main cineplex, main movie theaters were much more sort of fancy or even sort of elaborate and expensive, where you'd sometimes have theater shows or even a cinematic orchestra play during the movie or even before a movie. The main change with theater exhibition sort of comes with changes in Hollywood itself, because the old classical Hollywood studio system relied much more heavily on this tier of exhibition. So they play movies in the main theaters in parts of the city and parts of the country. And then there's actually a gap where the movie is not available anywhere in the United States. And then it goes to lower tiers. Maybe it goes to some of the states. And then it once again removes and it's no longer available. And then it sort of circulates for months and months by the time it spreads across. I think part of the change or this push into blockbusters, and you can see the the exhibitors building cinemas around this, is that that sort of prohibition of that tiered system has been removed. So it no longer functions technically like that. So that was a case, that was an aspect of the US Supreme Court antitrust case against Hollywood, saying that you actually created a tiered system in exhibition where you released your movies in your own theaters, and it effectively kept everyone else from getting their movies into theaters. Now, it doesn't seem that there's that, maybe there's an antitrust case here, I'm not sure, but it doesn't seem to be that sort of explicit in that way. There is that technical freedom for movies to be distributed in theaters if someone's interested, but that push, I think, has been related to the change in this building of cineplexes, that if you're going to have a big cineplex like that, you need maybe a few movies that will dominate that rather than sort of spread it thin, and if you have 24 screens, have 24 films. It seems to be the thing these days where you have a cineplex with 24 films. In some cases, you could have a blockbuster that could be on 6 or 7 of them, and it's just one film that's taking up that much space.
Okay. Kathleen? Okay, I have a question. So I know from your previous presentations and also from the things that you have written that you indicated that the view in Hollywood is that it's very hard to determine risk and that risk is very, very high, although it's hard to determine, but intuitively those who write about the subject claim that it's hard to think about it in low terms. It's always uncertain, high, rising, all those descriptive terms. Now, if we examine what happens to other forms of entertainment, for example, sports, Michael Lewis wrote the book called Moneyball, and they made a movie out of it, how they basically created a production function / capitalization function in baseball. And they're doing it in other sports. So essentially, they're quantifying it and able to get a sense of the risk. And they're doing it probably in publishing and so on and so forth. So I'm wondering, how is it possible that the conventional creed about Hollywood is that risk is either unquantifiable or otherwise very high, where you show a very clear historical decline in risk, and you document the way that this risk has been reduced deliberately, strategically. How is it possible that those who actually are engaged in it, and they are engaged in it conscientiously, it's impossible to think of this being just a spontaneous development. How is it not percolated and not emerged in the literature, in your opinion?
I think just to start to make sure that everyone's sort of clear with some of the assumptions that you were referring to, is that in some of the, particularly in the more sort of mainstream literature on risk in the Hollywood film business, they in fact claim that risk is actually not only sometimes high, that it's extremely high, to the point that you actually can't make any predictions whatsoever about the success of your own film investments. Now, I think one of the reasons that that is sort of still perpetuated, so one of the economists that wrote about it, Arthur Devaney, he referred to a screenwriter, a well-known screenwriter in Hollywood, saying, when it comes to the business side of Hollywood, nobody knows anything. And I think that to some extent is a bit of, I don't know if it's two things at once, but it's a bit of maybe a crutch, but even maybe a form of camouflage. It's sometimes easier to sort of say, no one really knows what they're doing. Sometimes movies are successful, sometimes they're not. Now, I think in the past few years, that might become a bit of a harder sell to still tell people that maybe people can't really make any predictions whatsoever about the success of their movies. When I started this project, I just tried to give myself a hypothetical example that if I was Warner Brothers and I got, I don't know, one of the sequels of Harry Potter, someone threw the sequel for one of the Harry Potter books onto my lap and said, here's the script for the next Harry Potter film, would I sit there and say, it's impossible to determine the revenues of this movie? It might make lots of money, but it might make $3 in theaters. So it might not always be easy to predict perfectly. That might never be the case. But this idea that with every script you get, you have to say to yourself, well, it could make $400 million or it could make $5, I think is something that allows, in a sense, for maybe some of these aspects to not really be focused on quite too much. Now, I don't want to get sort of make it sound like it's almost too sort of conspiratorial, because I think another aspect is the vested interest of people working in Hollywood keeping their jobs. So one of the sort of main turnovers is film executives. And film executives are usually very, very quickly punished for any sort of box office dud. So two or three vice presidents for Disney were quickly fired after, I think it was 2 years ago, when they released John Carter and The Lone Ranger with Johnny Depp. Neither of them did really well. And you know, when you think about it, why would someone in 2013 want to see a movie about The Lone Ranger? But when those movies sort of fell by the wayside, people lost their jobs. So there is, I think, also just a vested interest for people to kind of perpetuate this narrative saying, we don't really have our hands on the wheel. No one has their hands on the wheel. It's something that if we're lucky enough to make good movies, then good for us. Okay.
How has the relation I find fascinating, this relation between this growing correlation between the rank in theater distribution and rank in sales revenue. Could you elaborate more on how you think this is, just qualitatively, how this has been accomplished? Is advertising a part of it? What goes into this shaping, making sure that big release films don't fail?
Right. So I think it's a bunch of things, and I don't want to just give you a laundry list of all the, I think, elements, but I think the main thing to think about is that a very large release comes with its own large cost, that to release a film through wide release, you have to negotiate contracts with many exhibitors. And so if you're releasing big, other people might be making some of that money as well, but you have to cover many costs because you might say, well, I have to advertise. So I think qualitatively, I think one of the pushes has been, and I really feel like this is something that we all know very intimately now, which is the big franchise blockbusters. So Arthur Devaney, when he was looking at his own assessment of risk, he looked at 1985, and that was Back to the Future 1. And he made the example when he showed a Pareto distribution and sort of said Back to the Future was the number one movie in 1985. He said to himself, and I think understandably so, he said, how could Back to the Future become number one? Because before that movie, there was no Back to the Future series. So it might have been a bit of a shock of how popular it was. But qualitatively, you take that and you take that same analogy and you move it to now, and that sort of surprise of how some movies become big is not really there anymore, because qualitatively, most of the movies that that are released big are already connected to a few things. So you're no longer shocked when, you know, we haven't even gotten there yet, but I'm sure you've all been already seen many of the advertisements for Star Wars. But the sort of, once again, Disney's new push to saying Star Wars is back and it's bigger than ever, it already has this huge fan base, so that shock of it going to the top isn't really the same. So there's a lot of money spent, there's a lot of promotion that needs to be done, but there's even just decisions about, and this is, I think, why the VPs at Disney were punished for John Carter and the Lone Ranger. It's saying, we're doubling down on this. We're making big movies, and we're going to do it, I don't know for how long, but we're making franchise cinema for quite a while. Marvel has now released 3 origin stories of Spider-Man. Right? Batman just finished, but give it 2 or 3 years, there's going to be Batman versus Superman, and then people will kind of forget the Nolan brothers, and then they'll just do another Batman series. Right? So that sort of repetition is slightly different than even the blockbusters in the 80s. Somewhat. Yeah.
Just something I find curious, but sure. It seems like Hollywood, when it comes to the Oscars are focused on films in like bins 9, 10, whatever, like at the lower end, and not bins 1 and 2. And it seems like the whole industry is focused on these films, like the quality films, mm-hmm. whereas the ones that actually make the most in theaters, they're sort of left out. I wonder why the focus isn't on, you know, the bins 1 and 2. Like, why is there this focus on these quality films, like the low budget films? Like, how does that play into the industry? I assume it does, but it does. I don't know.
It really does, and I think what my analysis would need, and this would just take a bit more sort of me meticulously choosing a few films, is that some of the movies that are released in small theaters are in fact distributed by larger studios. So in that lower realm of cinema, you have those, but then you have independent distributors, you have maybe some people that they got a movie together and they actually found a way to release this movie in the States, so they got it in one theater. So some of the movies that are in the lower sort of tiers with respect to opening theaters are movies that Hollywood is interested in, but I think they still play the waiting game. So they still say, we'll release a few artistic films, and if a few of them become exceedingly popular, and some have over time, in the 90s, a huge one was, like, for example, Schindler's List. It's like a movie that, you know, it was sort of everyone's telling everyone else that you have to see. So if it sort of explodes in popularity, then the sort of the major studios can say, yeah, that's okay. I think what I would need to stress a bit more with maybe try to find a way to show it is that then there's these other films that are released by other distributors, other independent distributors. And these are the movies that you sort of want to know in the back of your mind, these are not going to be the ones that are really going to sort of boom in popularity. So the film critic Jonathan Rosenbaum wrote about The Blair Witch Project, and he said that The Blair Witch Project was really interesting because he argues that it was legitimately a popularity from below, that this was an independently distributed movie distributed by Artisan Entertainment. It opened in 11 theaters, and it really did catch this buzz, and it blew up. he makes the argument that by the time that we see it in Time magazine or on CNN or in Fox News, or I guess maybe Fox News wasn't really that big back then, but when it was sort of talked about on Entertainment Tonight about, ooh, the Blair Witch Project, he makes the argument that that's actually Hollywood being defensive, because they have just been exposed that someone else distributed a big popular movie. So now many of these firms that actually have also ownership of media are going to now get on the bandwagon and sort of say, oh yeah, Blair Witch, we love Blair Witch, it's so cool. But he says, if you look at it, this was legitimately a surprise. I think that's something that Hollywood might say, we're definitely not interested in that. Just another small fun fact about the Oscars though, in the past few years, the Best Picture category has been expanded to 9 films. And the reason that they did that was because they were starting to voice concern that every year at the Oscars, people in general, right, across the United States, didn't see any of the best Oscar nominees. So when you used to be nominated with just 4 or 5 films, if you didn't get a chance, or you don't see that many movies, or you only maybe see a few movies, very popular movies, each year you'd say, I've never seen any of these films. So what they did was they said, okay, we'll expand the Best Picture to 9. And if you look now that it's been expanded, there's now always 3 movies in there that are good movies, but they're closer to those top tiers. Pixar movies, I think even The Dark Knight was nominated. The Lord of the Rings films were all nominated for Best Picture. So they might not always be winning, but it's sort of saying, let's make sure that the focus is maybe where we want it to be.
Another question. So I think it's really interesting to follow up on Blair's question on how exactly does Hollywood and the large studios, how do they exactly determine the factors that go into their so-called production function? And more importantly, because determining what is important is a passive thing, you also want to shape what the consuming public, quote-unquote, wants, quote-unquote. And I think this is the most disturbing thing, because if you're showing a projection and a trajectory that shows that risk is declining, it's close to 1, meaning that they know exactly what is going to happen, and that means that the autonomy of the population is completely crushed. So my question is, first, do you have any ideas of how to proceed and investigate the methods by which they condition the population to basically accept so much garbage and consume it enthusiastically? And secondly, maybe more importantly, do you see any possible inversion of this trend? Because we tend to take the view that whatever the trajectory is, that's what's gonna happen in the future. But history is always humbling and surprises are often humiliating us. So do you see any kind of asymptote to this trajectory of limiting creativity and channeling it and conditioning the population at large to accept this type of entertainment?
So I think that this, my sort of, I guess, a quick two-part to that answer. So the first part is that right now I only have some anecdotal evidence, or I guess not totally anecdotal because it's journalistic, but some just qualitative sort of descriptions of how, for example, Hollywood has been very interested in things like machine learning algorithms, where they're creating databases where you can essentially try to break down a script into production functions. So you then feed that script into your database and then it will output it and it'll say, what to us might seem kind of ridiculous, but it'll say things, you know, the second character has blonde hair. If you change it to a brunette, you know, you'll get $10 more million. Or one of the recommendations is never make a movie about bowling. So that was one of the recommendations that one of these things said. It just said, if you make a movie about bowling, you're gonna, financially, you're gonna fail. Even though I really like The Big Lebowski. But it's just, So there is already that sort of push where wouldn't it be great if we could just get almost some really firm exact numbers on what we're doing. The other example, and Morgan Spurlock showed this in one of his documentaries, where they're now starting to use MRI machines, where they put people up to MRI machines and they show them film trailers. And based on that, you get an output of their brain waves, and they sort of try to track how to design trailers to sort of maximize excitement. So if you notice that in the middle of the trailer, people just kind of become a bit bored and they're waiting for the very end, how do you design a trailer to just maintain 2 minutes of just pure fun, I guess? The other thing is that I think part of this push for risk has, it's not exactly so much about just Hollywood involved in this activity. I think one of the reasons that Hollywood's profits have gone sideways, and I show this in another chart which I didn't show here, is that per capita attendance has been stagnating since the 60s. So on average, from 1960 all the way up until now, the average American only sees 5 movies in theaters per year. So I think one of these sort of pushes has been Hollywood is having a difficult time, I think, getting people to watch more films. I think there's all sorts of entertainment out there. I still watch movies, but you know, there's so many other ways now to, you can watch TVs getting better. There's Netflix, there's lots of sports. So movies are not now the main source of entertainment. So I think part of this potential asymptote would be, can Hollywood ever, if it needs to, change gears and start to say, we need to play a different game where we need to now convince people to watch more movies, to actually maybe say, we need to ignite a love of cinema, which we haven't really been doing. We've just sort of saying, watch certain films, but can we sort of bring it back to this idea that Americans and by proxy Canadians would be seeing a movie very, like, much more often? In the 40s and 30s, people were seeing a movie a week. They, like, this was like the main cultural activity for a lot of Americans. So that decline has maybe pushed them to say, we need to just now make sure people are watching what we're giving them. But if one day trends change, they might have to say, no, we have a new goal and we have to try to convince people to watch 10 movies a year or 20 movies a year. I don't know. And that might be a challenge because there's so much out there. The other thing I should say is that part of my research is that I want to get into is that through media conglomeration, eventually maybe my focus on cinema might become not irrelevant, but I might need to change a focus because some companies might say, I now maybe even care less if people are watching my movies because I have movies, I have television. So Netflix might be this new thing where they can say, you can just watch whatever, and we have a new model, and we're not really trying to say, well, yes, they recommend things, but it's a different sort of consumption than it used to be, where people used to look at a newspaper and say, what are we going to see on Friday, right?
Well, just a comment. I really enjoyed the presentation. One area, a small area, where I thought you seem to equate like profitability to ticket sales in theaters. Mm-hmm. And as I understand it, I'm no expert by any means, but that a lot of the profit that these companies make, mm-hmm, come from the back end, like IP, mm-hmm, libraries that then they license to Netflix, yep, and that theaters, I mean, that's a separate business and they have competing interests with, to some extent. I mean, I found at times you seem to be painting Hollywood as like this amorphous entity. And I think it would be beneficial to try to tease out some of the conflicts and sort of separations.
Oh, yeah, I completely agree. So I think one of the reasons why at least this presentation and a few of my figures have still focused on theater data is there's always some different elements. One is just this data is available. It's easy to find. So I have found data on the profitability, but it's usually, in many cases, it's not disaggregated. So you can go into annual reports and you can look at the profitability of certain sectors of maybe Disney or Time Warner, but it's not always giving you that sort of, we're going to break it down exactly how you're sort of hoping to look. The other reason that I still think it's, and I hope maybe I'm not implying that yes, theater revenues equals profitability, because that I think you're completely correct, that there now is a much longer story of how Hollywood is profiting, not just getting sales. But I think one of the reasons that it's still useful to look at theater revenues is because it's still, and it might be changing, but it's still, in my opinion, that it's maybe not the main mode of profit, but it's still, it's that tentpole. It's the first sort of piece in this longer sort of story. So if nobody is seeing your franchise film in theaters, this might not become that franchise that some companies want it to be. So I completely agree that Disney is not, yes, it's releasing Star Wars films, but Star Wars, now that it purchased Lucasfilm, it's a cultural universe. It's in so many different forms of media. So if it says, yes, if I profit off of t-shirts and video games, even better. But it still seems that part of that story is Trill's trying to say, okay, if we're still gonna play the movie game, what are gonna be those releases that are maybe gonna hopefully kickstart some of these waves? It might change, and sometimes you can argue that it goes in different ways, because Harry Potter was a giant book franchise before it was a film franchise, but it was also a giant film franchise that sort of carries that story.
You okay? Everybody is satisfied with their questions? Okay, thank you very much, James. Interesting presentation, very interesting.